You are listening to the API The Docs podcast. We are here to talk about API documentation, upstream and downstream.
You know, we don't necessarily hear that direct feedback, but something that's kind of even better is we have some metrics where we can see how many people have actually gone to those links. And so we're not necessarily hearing from them, but that's kind of a good thing. The no news is good news situation.
Mentoring and knowledge sharing is a part of our culture. We encourage pair programming, for example, and people in a pair aren't always a senior and a junior. Sometimes it's two senior people, two junior people.
I think one of the things that helps the developers that I work with is that on this new portal, we actually came out with a few use cases. So developers are able to kind of go there and see what can I do with the API.
Hello and welcome to the API The Docs podcast. Your host today and myself, Anett, Pozsár, and my colleague, Laura Vass. In our daytime jobs, we research and build developer portals at Pronovix. Hi, Laura.
Hi, Anett. Hi. Yeah, so a bit of an intro story. Last year in August, a Nordic APIs blog, Bill Durfeld, as the editor, he recommended us, the API The Docs podcast, among the 9 API podcasts to listen to. And like, well, thank you, Bill, that was awesome. And then this article finished on this ominous note that, well, it remains to be seen how long the organizers will continue to support these shows along with other content. And well, that kind of jinxed it for us. So we were really busy for a semester with those other endeavors, namely the API The Docs conference and yeah, the DevRel awards and, you know, work and things like that. But we're back.
Yeah.
And we're back with actually 2 representatives of the API team of one of the most well-known scheduling platforms, Calendly. And Calendly just published their new API portal, as far as I know, the DevRel, and the version 2 of their API. So there's lots to talk about. So warm welcome to our guests, Kristyn, Bryan, and Dmitry Pashkevich. Hi.
Hi.
Hello.
So a short intro, who are you and what's your roles? Where are you at Calendly and in your careers? What I know is that, Kristyn, you're on developer support and you're support the developers with the API and your background is in teaching web development and, teaching web development.
Yes. Yeah. I was both an elementary school teacher in a past life and then transitioned into teaching web development.
And how did you get into the API team of Calendly?
I had been using Calendly at another company that I was working with and found the product to be really interesting and decided when I wanted to transition out of just doing web development and just doing teaching that I wanted to check out Calendly and where my skills could kind of come together. So it turns out that, you know, they have roles supporting web developers with the API and it was a great fit.
Mm-hmm. And when we say you support developers with the API, is that from alpha till omega or you have a specific scope in that?
So I support developers who want to create their own apps with the API, and I support developers who are using our embeds and want to kind of customize, or if they are having, they need help implementing things into their own websites, I'm there to help them.
Mm-hmm. And we have your colleague, Dmitry. Who is an application architect. And what I know is that you focus on the API design at Calendly. And you've been working in the API and the integration space for 6 years now. Is this correct? And what is your daily job look like? What do you do?
This is correct. And prior to my application architect role, I actually worked as an engineer on Calendly's integration teams and later Calendly's API team that Kristyn also worked with. In that capacity, I worked directly on various integrations and later on what is now called API V2 at Calendly, our public API. But in the architect capacity, I'm less involved in the day-to-day feature development, but I work with these teams closely, support them in their efforts, and ensure that the way we build things aligns with our future technology vision.
Mm-hmm. And the whole team who's working strictly on the API or at Calendly, how many are you and what kind of roles do you have in that team?
So the team that we're talking about actually mainly focuses on Calendly's public API offering. They built the dev portal. They're continuing to add features to it. So that team is primarily public facing. However, increasingly more and more teams at Calendly focus on building APIs because that's where we're shifting our internal product development effort. We're embracing the so-called API first product delivery paradigm.
Mm-hmm. And as far as the number is concerned, I think for the API, external facing API team, we only have about, what, 4 engineers right now on that team. Is that right, Dmitry?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Actually, 5. We now got a new developer.
Ah, yeah. The team's growing.
Yeah, as far as we know, the current developer portal is up and running since this February. I mean, publicly, at least. Is this true? And do you have is this your first developer portal?
It's our first developer portal of this generation. We used to have a more basic API reference page out there. The developer portal that you see today, it's been up for about a year, but recently we made some substantial design changes to it. So we decided to go with a public announcement and our work is not done yet.
I think one of the things that helps the developers that I work with is that on this new portal, we actually came out with a few use cases. So developers are able to kind of go there and see what can I do with the API. And these use cases are written for folks that don't even necessarily have a development background, but perhaps like a product team from another company goes and takes a look to see what they can do and then passes the documentation along to their developers. So that's a nice enhancement on this new version of the dev portal.
I see. And did you receive some kind of feedback about there is a need for use cases or other supporting documentation on the portal, or what made this change or transition with the new portal?
I think the thought behind the use cases came from a few places. So one of the places is the developers that I speak with, some of the common questions that they ask. So instead of just being able to answer folks like one at a time, we put the most popular requests out there so that they can just access that externally. And then I think another place that it came from is our product manager for the API. He sometimes works with, you know, other large software companies. And so the things that he was hearing from them that would be helpful to know, we've put those all together in the use case area.
Do you have some kind of an API strategy you can tell about?
We do, and this is where API V2 development started. The previous generation of our API, which is now deprecated, hoping to shut it down in the next year, it did not really have a cohesive strategy. We put out a few endpoints, webhook functionality, as a direct response to customer requests, and then we kept adding to that, again, just by directly satisfying specific use cases that some of our customers asked for. And while we made these customers happy, what resulted is a fairly inconsistent API that is hard to evolve, that has some legacy things that we quickly regretted. So when we went about building the next generation of our API platform, we really decided to put down a design strategy that will help us build things in a more evolvable way, in a more future-proof way. And we have these principles documented internally, and we're following them as we design things. So we're trying to not, while we honor customer feedback, we constantly listen, and Kristyn helps a lot in distilling customer feedback back to the team. When we go about delivering new API resources, we try to think about a broad variety of use cases, and what we expose is not really use case specific endpoints, but capabilities of our product in API form.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned customer feedback, and it's always an interesting topic for us. Can you share us a bit more? How do you collect feedback, and is there a team which processes it, or how does it work?
Yeah, typically we get feedback via email, and my team, the developer support team, we're the ones who interact with the developers. So they'll write in and have questions or provide some feedback to us. We collect that information, and we are able to pass that along to the API squad. We have like a monthly sort of newsletter that we write up, and we provide, you know, examples of what a use case is and what people are requesting. And we track that information as well. So if we ever do, or when we do, put out new releases, we're actually, my team's able to reach back out to everyone who has requested that feature in the past, and we're able to like surprise them and let them know that the endpoint is ready. We also have a release notes page on our dev portal that just recently you can subscribe to, it so you can see all of the endpoints that have been released, and we get the information out to them that way as well.
That's really cool that you go back and say, hey, you know, your feedback was taken very seriously. That's a very nice surprise.
I wish every company did that. Every company that I wrote into saying, you know what, it would be great if they reached back out to me and let me know it actually came to fruition, what I asked for. So yeah, we're happy to do it.
That's really super. I wanted to still ask about that API first, but we're in feedback territory, and I know that Anett is super, super interested in feedback, because it's once you start actually gathering feedback, then it comes like, oh yeah, like, wow, what do we do now?
Yeah, because we have a lot of assumptions about our users, and yeah, they are biased somewhat, but when you hear actual feedback and they are pointing out things you didn't even know, it's just mind-blowing, and it's really great, I guess.
Yeah. So when you decided to completely redesign the API, the public-facing API, was also feedback considered, or this was mostly from an architect's point of view, you saw already that this needs to change to make it future-proof, or this actually came from outside? I don't know if I may ask such a thing.
Yeah, I think your question makes sense. It was primarily an internal architecture decision. As I shared in the earlier example, the way API V1 worked, it certainly satisfied a number of use cases, but the way it was built and continued to be built made it challenging to continue to add support, new use cases, without significantly changing the design, without deprecating things, without introducing breaking changes. So the latest API V2, it a lot of the design principles that went down in it really follow the industry known best practices on building REST APIs. We just weren't deliberate about employing them in the past.
Mm-hmm. This also sounds like the moment when business would perk up and like, okay, we also want to be a part of this because actually we have needs here.
Right. API is increasingly important both inside businesses and as a thinking about API as a product, not just an accessory, a means to an end, has been a mental shift here.
Do you feel that in the API team, like either in a mindset change or in the way the composition of the team is shifting?
Absolutely. The API team at Calendly is a product team. We have a product manager. The team follows the same process for evolving a product than any other team. Their success metrics might be different, but we do product discovery. We have a design phase in our API, and the same agile product development loop applies to our API product.
And circling back to feedback and helping supporting developers, all the new case studies that you are publishing on the new dev portal, do you see that in the feedback coming from like support side, like developers saying, "Hey, that's awesome, and I'm hooked, but help me there." But it was the actual use case that got me hooked.
We don't necessarily hear that direct feedback, but something that's kind of even better is we have some metrics where we can see how many people have actually gone to those links, and so we're not necessarily hearing from them, but that's kind of a good thing, the no news is good news situation, and that they don't need to reach out to us for support because they're able to self-serve now that they have those. So we have seen, a lot of traffic on those links and fewer tickets coming in. So to me, that's great news.
Mm-hmm. And in the case studies that you mentioned, we celebrate our partners who have built valuable integrations for our mutual customers by just consuming our platform. This is the one of the ultimate rewards that we're looking forward to. We build this platform, and then internally, there are so many integrations that we can build ourselves, even if we had several thousand employees. But by building a platform, we hope that all these other companies can create integrations, sometimes serving specific needs of a market segment that's just work.
Mm-hmm. And who wrote these use cases, translating it to roles in your team?
So the use cases were written by a few people on my team, the developer support team. We had our product manager work with us to decide what exactly the use cases would be. My team wrote down the information, the instructions on how to use the API. And then we had another person on our content team who was able to go through and, review it before posting it online. So it was definitely effort of a lot of folks to get those use cases written.
Do you have technical writers at Calendly?
We don't at the moment. I know that's something that the team is looking to hire in the future, but the writing was done by the developer support team, and I have a background in software engineering, and another person on the team does as well. So we don't have the technical writer right now, but that's definitely something that we want to do as we grow and scale, and especially as we think about potentially starting a developer community. We would want someone who has that kind of skill and knowledge for those external facing interactions.
And when someone joins your company, how does the onboarding happen? Are there any milestones?
Like the API team, yeah.
One thing that I've appreciated about Calendly, I still remember my onboarding, and you know, this was a few years ago. It certainly got a lot. It's only improved since then. One thing that every Calendly employee goes through when they start is product training. That's what they do their first week. So whether they're in sales or development or marketing, they spend at least a week deep diving into the product so that they can know the product in and out. Anyone who has used Calendly as to book time, they know how simple and straightforward that is. But that experience of the invitee is really the tip of the iceberg. If you're a customer of Calendly, you know that there's so many ways you can configure how people book time with you, and there's team functionality and all the other automations you can set up. So every person is trained. They have homework. They have quizzes, so that they really deeply understand the product, so that they can be efficient in their role. And then for the development team, there's a certain sequence for developer onboarding. They of course set up their environment, set up all the apps, and there's a series of overview sessions with different members of the engineering team. There's an architecture overview session that I and my colleagues conduct. Typically the people that land on the API team have some prior experience working with API integrations or interest in learning.
What's an overview session? Is that like an ask me anything moment, or?
It's a semi-structured session. For example, the architecture overview session is a session where we go over at a high level Calendly's technology stack and infrastructure and how our standards for development in different parts of our stack, like database management, front-end, back-end, what languages we use, how different systems talk together.
Uh-huh. So it's like a teaching session
there are also sessions on all the tools, all the products that we use to be effective, you know, logging, monitoring, all communication, all these things.
Mm-hmm. A little bit veering away from technical writing strictly, but do you also do mentoring? I saw this for me, surprising feedback from senior colleagues, how deeply they appreciate to have the chance to mentor younger colleagues. So, you know, obviously it's nice to be mentored, but that the experience of mentoring somebody else, that it's actually a great thing in life. And I wonder if you do this mentoring or call it any other word for the same meaning. Do you do that? And what are your experiences with that, specifically in the API team?
We do, not just specific to the API team, but mentoring and knowledge sharing is a part of our culture. We encourage pair programming, for example, and people in a pair aren't always a senior and a junior. Sometimes it's two senior people, two junior people, using that time and space to share knowledge. For junior engineers or people interested in switching into engineering, we also have a formal apprenticeship program. Kristyn, do you want to add anything on your side from your team?
Sure, yeah. So on my side of developer support, we used to have a more formal mentorship program that was actually called mentorship program, where the more senior people mentored the newer folks to the team. And we would meet and we'd go over different topics. And we're just as a mentor, you're the person who they can go to with questions. And I think that, especially with this new remote first experience, it's really nice to have that kind of relationship and to be able to build a closer bond with people when we're not in the office anymore. And you can't just it's not just easy to turn to the person next to you and ask a question. To have a mentor that you can kind of go to and to be that first person that you can connect with is a nice way to keep people together right now.
So is this mentoring is more like a mentor in the distance or someone who can talk and ask your questions, or is it like a closer hand-holding kind of relationship?
It's different for every team, but on my team as the mentor, you're the one who is there to kind of answer some of the bigger questions. But also I meet with everybody, like all of the people that I mentor, to go over different things within the company. So new releases, I make sure that everybody's caught up on, we're constantly releasing new features. So I want to make sure that we're all on the same page with what's going on with Calendly. And also in my mentorship, we actually do take some time to do some team building and bonding, and we play games together. So I know that's probably different from what the engineering folks do, but that's what we do in the developer support and customer success departments.
What would be a team building exercise that you do?
Some team building exercises. We actually have been playing a few different games, some drawing games, Scribble.io. We have done the Hada, which is a logic puzzle game we've been doing together for a couple of months. But we all work together on the same puzzle and do it collaboratively, and it's all within the browser, so we can be looking at the same window when we're on a Zoom call. And yeah, it's nice to kind of do a challenge together that is not necessarily work-related and just helps us build trust with each other.
Mm-hmm. That sounds cool. Especially when it comes to writing and then a lockdown, it's like, even if you weren't an introvert until now, you certainly are at this point. So
yeah,
good to remember to regroup animals.
Kristyn also reminded me in engineering, when a new person joins, they are assigned an onboarding buddy. And it is that's go-to person that will probably do some hand-holding in the beginning and be the go-to person to answer any question until the new hire gets a little more comfortable and meets new people and knows where to get help on their own.
I also think that when it comes to APIs, which are very ephemeral, there's no tactile experience with the product. It's a thing that isn't a thing. It's even more important to have some sort of mentoring, because you don't get that very tactile product connection that you can get attached to, like with a bottle, or I don't mean it that way, so a physical product. But when it comes to an API, the more philosophical you get, the harder it is to comprehend what is it even, unless you find your way to get attached to it. And then, your fellow humans are good to connect to in that way. But this is inside. How is it for from the outside developers, this getting started experience? Because, well, in our daytime jobs, we're pretty busy with that.
Yeah, so what makes a good getting started talks like?
Yeah, so part of our, we have those use cases, as I mentioned, but we also actually have a getting started guide for developers who want to use our product, and it kind of walks them through different scenarios.
Did it significantly change how you do this with version 2?
I don't believe we had a getting started guide with API V1, and we're focusing more on self-serve experience with API V2. We're adding more self-serve capabilities to our dev portal right now, so the developers can actually register and provision all the credentials that they need. And then I think we're going to be adding more interactive elements, so that time from signing up to become a developer to making your first API call is as short as possible.
Do you have numbers for that right now?
We don't right now.
Did you test your API documentation with someone internally or externally?
We have. Actually, new hires are great guinea pigs there. And
always.
new hire always has this privilege of a fresh perspective, and we try to take advantage of it. When a new person joins them, they usually share some feedback, point out things that we may be used to that could be improved.
And what were you testing? So joining as an architect and joining as developer support, what were you asked to test when you joined?
For developer support, I didn't actually interview with Calendly for this job specifically. There actually was not a developer support team when I started. Once I did start this team, I definitely tested out every single endpoint that we had.
Wow.
And I transitioned to the architect role internally. And prior to that, I was on the team who built API V2, so I did have that bias. Didn't have the privilege of a fresh perspective.
Okay. But
I remember back when I interviewed with Calendly a few years ago, and Calendly only had the legacy V1 public API. I remember it immediately kind of occurred to me as something odd that the only way to authenticate with the API was by generating an API key. There's no OAuth support for one of the exercises that I had to do within my interviews to build a simple application that would consume the Calendly API. And it struck me as odd that OAuth was not supported at the time. So that's one of the things we fixed in the API V2.
You mentioned that you're building the developer community now, and it's one of your objectives. How does that look like for you now, building a developer community in a sort of hybrid? Everyone's stuck in their own continent. It's COVID, but it's not. How does building a developer community look like right now in your context?
We actually have not started that yet. That's something that we would love to do, but it's not there yet. I don't know, Dmitry, if you have anything to add there, but I think our team, the first thing that our developer support team has been doing is trying to bring more people on to support developers, because for a while it was just me for over a year. And it went from just me to now 8 people on the team supporting developers. So we were kind of building out the support first. And then I think the next thing will be a community.
Yeah, as Kristyn said, we don't have our own developer community platform today. There's so many things when building an API platform from scratch that you know you want to have, but you have a small team. There's only so much you can do at a time. So we haven't got to cultivating our own developer community platform. But that said, we try to tap into existing developer community places. We try to monitor Stack Overflow questions where people ask about Calendly. They're trying to do something with their API and they're having trouble. In more limited fashion, GitHub as well, we have a demo application, or sometimes Calendly is mentioned in other projects. People write articles on using Calendly API, which is very rewarding, and we try to keep an eye out for these kinds of resources too. So we're definitely trying to be part of the broader development community, even without having our own platform.
Mm-hmm. So be awesome and helpful first, throw a party at second.
Yes.
Do you already see the next milestone in the future of the Calendly developer portal?
The next major milestone we're working on now is the capability for developers to actually register on that portal and manage their application credentials. Right now, the process is manual. So that's coming later this year, actively working on it.
Did you receive feedback around this? So is this a demand or?
I told you it's your favorite topic.
Yeah. Sorry.
This is one of those things that are, a no-brainer for a mature API platform. Of course, you need to be able to register and manage things on their own. But we weren't able to get to it earlier just because we had a small team and we wanted to focus on actually building a solid foundation in terms of the actual API resources, that's API endpoints that people can call to build something real.
Yeah, looking forward to seeing where it evolves.
Yeah, I was going to say you can visit, check out the developer portal at developer.calendly.com.
Dmitry, you also wanted to say something.
Oh, just API. I've been a big believer of API first, which really changes how you think about your product. Yeah, instead of thinking about product features in terms of specific functionality in your application, you start with designing an API for product capability, and that's been very transformative for Calendly. And I think we're also seeing the adoption of such approach in the industry as well. So we're maybe a little bit late, but glad we're going through that transformation, and I would recommend everyone to check it out.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, and thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the API the Docs podcast. Thanks again to our guest, to Pronovix, for letting us work on this, and the entire API the Docs community for all of the mutual support and sharing of experiences that you give each other. Do you have a topic or guest you would like us to spotlight? Drop a note at podcast@pronovix.com. If you go to the website apithedocs.org, you can find the recaps and recordings of past API the Docs conferences, as well as the upcoming program. Until next time, be well.